During the 19th century, the Qing dynasty was weakened by famines, natural disasters, economic problems, and a major defeat with the First Opium War. Farmers were overtaxed, rents rose, and peasants deserted their lands. The government, led by Manchus, became increasingly more corrupt. Anti-Manchu sentiment was strongest in the south among the Hakka community, a Han Chinese minority. In 1837, Hong Huizhu, a Hakka from Guangdong, failed the imperial exam for the third time, leading to a nervous breakdown. While recovering, Hong dreamed that he was a part of a celestial family. His celestial father said that men worshipped demons and suggested Hong should adopt the name Hong Yuzhuang. In 1843, Hong failed the exam for the fourth and final time. Hong soon believed that his celestial father was God, his brother was Jesus Christ, and he had been ordered to rid the world of demons, including the Qing government. Hong began preaching across Guangxi in 1844, and his follower Feng Yuxian founded the God-worshipping society, following Han's fusion of Christianity, Taoism, and Confucianism. Suppression by authorities saw the movement take up guerrilla warfare. Eventually, two others claimed to have the ability to speak as members of the celestial family, Yang Yuxing, representing God, and Zhao Shaoji, representing Jesus Christ. The Taiping Rebellion began in Guangxi when officials started a campaign of religious persecution against the God-worshipping society. Hong declared himself the Heavenly King of the Taiping Heavenly Kingdom in January 1851. The Taipings moved north, recruiting as they went. The Taiping took Nanjing in March of 1853, with Hong declaring it as his capital. Cleansing the city of demons, Manchu men would be killed and the women expelled or burned. Also in 1853, Hong took a step back from making decisions and policy making. Instead, he lived a life of luxury and surrounded himself with women. He made bizarre religious decisions, like keeping the sexes separate and having the act of intercourse, even while married, punishable by death. He didn't get along with Yang Jijing, who disagreed with his ideas, and he became paranoid about Yang. This resulted in Yang and his followers' execution, marking the beginning of the end for the Heavenly Kingdom. In Yunnan, Zhang Zhufan led a local army, the Zhaiying Army. The Zhaiying Army pushed back the Taiping advance in the west and took back control of many areas in Huaibei and Zhangji. In 1860, the Taiping defeated the Qing forces surrounding Nanjing and took over parts of southern Jiangsu and Zhenjiang, including the cities of Hangzhou, Chengzhou, and Zhuzhou. But while the Taiping were focused on these areas, Zhang's army moved down the Yangtze River. A small army led by European officers like Charles George Gordon and Frederick Townsend Ward, known as the Ever-Victorious Army, stopped the Taiping from taking over Shanghai on August 1860. The next year, Zhang Zhufan's army captured Anqing. The Taiping rebels tried one last time to take over cities like Ningbo and Hangzhou, and failed to capture Shanghai. In May 1862, the Zhaiying Army surrounded Nanjing, conducting a destructive two-year siege. Hong believed that God would protect Nanjing, putting his trust in God that the siege would end by divine intervention. He would then die of food poisoning in June 1864. A few days later, the Qing army took Nanjing and burned Hong's body, shooting his ashes out of a cannon so that he wouldn't have a proper resting place as punishment for leading the rebellion. No one really knows how many people died in the Taiping Rebellion, as there are no official records of the time. The consensus is around 20 to 30 million soldiers and civilians. Most of these deaths were because of sickness and starvation. This made the Taiping Rebellion the most deadliest civil war in human history. In 1851, the Yellow River flood changed its course and resulted in an immense loss of life. In 1855, the river burst its banks again, the destruction giving way to famine. The regime was unable to provide relief, enraging the Nian movement, a large faction of bandits who began to raid villages. The Nian united under Zhang Lexing, conquering large swaths of land and devastating the provinces of Jiangsu and Hunan. Zhang Lexing would be killed in an ambush in 1863. The Nian movement survived as Taiping commanders took control of the Nian. The remaining Nian forces split into two, leaving large swaths of Nian territory exposed. By late 1867, Qing troops retook most of the Nian territory, and in early 1868, the rebellion was crushed. Despite the Nian's failure to seize power, the rebellion harmed the Qing dynasty. The fighting ruined the countryside and drained government finances. In the long term, the Nian Rebellion was to become one of the major factors in the collapse of Qing China. As southern China burned with the war against the Nian and the Taiping, another rebellion erupted in China's west. In 1862, people called the Hui, or Dungan, who were Muslim, were afraid of the Han people, so they made their own militias to protect themselves. They started a rebellion in Gansu and Shaanxi because they thought they were being treated unfairly. The Dungan attacked Xian, with the Qing stopping the siege in late 1863. Later in 1867, a Qing general named Zhu Songtang was sent to stop the fighting. He looked to reclaim Gansu, gathering 65,000 troops from Hunan, Sichuan, Henan, and Henan to do so. There was also another Dungan revolt in Xinjiang. They attacked cities like Kashgar, Rumqi, and Naxu. A Kirklandian general named Yakob Beg came to help the Dungan and took over Kashgar in 1865 and soon much of Xinjiang. Later, Zhu was sent to stop the fighting in Xinjiang. He took over Rumqi without a fight, and soon after, Yakob's army disintegrated. Yakob died in 1877, and the Qing army took control of the area. Roughly 50% of Xinjiang's population died, an estimation of over 12 million deaths. Some of the Dungan fled to Imperial Russia, still surviving today as Muslim minorities in Kyrgyzstan and Kazakhstan. In the late 1800s, the Chinese became angry at foreigners influencing their country. Christian missionaries were allowed to preach in China and build churches. In 1897, two German priests were killed in the Juyi incident. The Germans sent soldiers to take over Jiaozu as preparations. Afterwards, Britain, France, Russia, and Japan scrambled to control parts of China too. At the same time, a group called the Righteous and Harmonious Fists, also known as the Boxers, grew in Shandong. They were hostile towards Christian missionaries and Chinese converts. They hated foreign influences and wanted to protect their traditional values. They believed that they had special powers that made them invincible to Western weapons, strengthening their confidence that they could topple foreign rule in China. The Empress of China at the time, Empress Dowager Cixi, started to support the Boxers as she shared their views. As a result, the Boxer power base moved into the Beijing area. The Western powers, in fear of the Boxers, requested that their diplomatic legations in Beijing be given more protection. After the Qing agreed, troops from eight nations, Britain, Russia, Japan, France, Germany, the United States, Italy, and Austria-Hungary, sent their troops to fortify their missions in Beijing. On the 5th of June, 1900, the Boxers cut the rail lines from Beijing to Taishan, isolating the capital and the legations. On the 11th, Boxers were first seen in the legations, provoking the Germans to execute a captured Boxer boy. In response, thousands of Boxers stormed Beijing and burned Christian churches and followers. British and German soldiers shot at the Boxers, alienating the Chinese and nudging the Qing government towards supporting the Boxers. As the situation deteriorated, the eight nations sent another 2,000 soldiers, led by Vice Admiral Edward Seymour from Britain. Seymour reached Lafang, quickly finding his army surrounded. They were attacked by the Boxers and the Qing, who won a costly but major victory over Seymour's troops at the Battle of Lafang on the 18th of June. Seymour's troops were harassed by Chinese artillery and cavalry. They ran low on food, ammunition, and medical supplies. Luckily for them, they found a hidden Chinese arsenal that had lots of supplies, choosing to stay there and wait for help to come. 1,800 more soldiers came to help, and they reached Taishan safely by the 22nd. Some 62 of Seymour's men were killed. The The Eight Nations would keep on sending more ships and landing more troops to restore communication with the Legations in Beijing, capturing forts to reinforce their military presence. In reaction to the Eight Nations' demands that China surrender, Empress Dowager Cixi would question that, if we just fold our arms and yield to them, I would have no face to see our ancestors after death. If we must perish, why don't we fight to the death? She would then order the blockade of the Beijing Legations, demanding that the Legations leave China. The Legations refused. So she would declare war on the Eight Nation Alliance on June 21st. Regional governors in the south of China, who also held China's best equipped armies, viewed the declaration as invalid. The Legation Quarter, where many foreign citizens, soldiers, marines, and sailors took refuge, was put under siege from the Chinese army and the Boxer rebels for almost 2 months. They defended the compound with small arms and one old muzzle-loaded cannon. The Chinese army surrounded the Legation Quarter with barricades and slowly pushed forward to attack. The Chinese shot bullets, shells, and fireworks at the Legations almost every night, but failed to do much damage. The Germans and the Americans oversaw the Tartar Wall along the south, some 14 meters tall and 12 meters wide. The Chinese built barricades closer and closer to the Germans and Americans until the Germans were forced to retreat. Then the Americans were all alone. One American marine described the scene. Their yells were deafening, while the roar of gongs, drums, and horns sounded like thunder. They waved their swords and stamped on the ground with their feet. They wore red turbans, sashes, and garters over blue cloth. They are now only 20 yards from our gate. Three or four volleys from the Libo rifles of our Marines left more than 50 dead on the ground. On July 3rd, a group of British, Russian, and American soldiers attacked the Chinese barricades and killed about 20 of them. After that, the Chinese didn't try to take the Tartar Wall again. On July 17th, an armistice was signed. The Chinese army caused a lot of trouble for the foreigners, and more than 40% of the Legation guards were killed or hurt. Finally, the Chinese government agreed to stop the fighting, and the siege was over. The Qing probably stopped the fighting upon their realization that an allied force of 20,000 men had landed in China and was coming to get them back. The armistice lasted until the 13th of August, when an allied army led by British Lieutenant General Alfred Gaselee approached Beijing to relieve the siege. With Taiping as a base, Allies marched on Beijing with 20,000 troops through unbearable and deadly heat. Along the way, Allied soldiers beheaded dead Chinese corpses, beheaded Chinese civilians, and raped Chinese girls and women. The Chinese responded to the Alliance's atrocities with similar acts of violence and cruelty. The international force reached Beijing on the 14th of August. In the early hours of August 15th, Empress Dowager Cixi, dressed like a farm woman, escaped Beijing. After weeks of travel, the party arrived in Xi'an in Sanji. The Boxer Rebellion ended on September 7th with the signing of the Boxer Protocol. The Allies soon took control of Beijing and the surrounding area. Some of the nations, like the Germans, French, and Japanese, continued carrying out atrocities against civilians due to the paranoia of the Boxers. As part of the Boxer Protocol, the Qing were forced to pay $333 million at the time to the Eight Nations for the next 39 years. The Boxer Rebellion highlighted the Qing's now permanent weakness. Anti-Qing sentiment gradually increased as the government attempted to modernize the empire. It would be in vain, as over 2,000 years of dynastic rule in China came to an end with the Xinghai Revolution in 1911, establishing the Republic of China.